Hello everybody, I welcome you all in this new edition of News Coverage and Analysis from the Hindu newspaper dated 23rd March 2019. So in this edition I have taken only 3 articles and all of them are from editorial section. I have not gone into other news because I could not find any new news that could be of any importance for your prelims examination. There are news, but those are repetitive news and we have been talking about them. So I decided that since now only 2 months are left, we should rather focus on key articles, and these 3 articles might not be that important for your prelims but would certainly be important for your mains examination, because there you might these questions related to these articles certainly can be asked. So let's start with the first article, next stage in great game. This is related to Afghanistan. The writer Suhasini Haider feels that defeatism will hurt India's interest more than the Taliban's return to Kabul could. Now let's try to understand what is the story so far. An international talk with the Taliban leadership gained momentum. India's foreign policy establishment has gone through the 5 stages of grief. First is the denial, then a sense of anger, then started bargaining to get into the picture, then a sense of depression, and finally the acceptance. Now what are these 5 different modes? Let's try to understand. Now after the initial denial that several countries including the US, Russia, UAE, Qatar, Saudi Arabia were engaging with Pakistan in order to bring senior Taliban leader to the table in late 2017, India protested against being cut out of the talk. So this was a sense of denial when these countries, big countries, US, Russia, UAE, Qatar and Saudi Arabia, these all including China and Russia, were all engaging with Pakistan or all prodding Pakistan to bring Taliban to the table. At that point of time, India was in denial and India always thought that this would never happen, and you know, a talk engaging Pakistan to bring Taliban to the table would never succeed, and that was a sense of denial on India's part. Now the moment India started seeing the result and have seen that Pakistan again have come to the center stage, India witnessed a sense of anger, and that's what the author is saying. Now India then negotiated to join them, and that was the bargaining that is mentioned here, followed by expression of deep misgiving over where the talks would lead, because now India realized have realized that actually the initial premise based on which Taliban was ousted and a government was installed at Afghanistan has completely been left out. Now no country including US or other parties who helped America in, you know, ousting Taliban from Afghanistan have completely forgotten those premises, and now Taliban is the one dictating terms, and that's why India is getting into a sense of depression. And finally, this has given way to the acceptance today that the talk have not only progressed but are being given priority over every other processes in Afghanistan except the initial premise. Now what are the progresses and misgivings? The last round of talk between US special envoy Jalmay Khalilzad and Taliban leader in Doha appeared to have held on Taliban's term and at a venue of its choice. So you can see, or in fact we have been talking about, that it is the Taliban which is dictating its terms, and America is in hurry to push out, and because of that Pakistan is at the center stage, India is left out, India is not even a party to the regional talk which is talking about bringing regional stability, and that could happen only after bringing in Taliban. So nobody is talking about India and nobody is taking India's view as what should be done, whether Taliban should be involved or not, and if at all involved, what should be the modality. So modalities are discussed with Pakistan, not with India, and India is the one which has been suffering, and India is the one which has always been saying that Pakistan is the one which has created Taliban, and involving Pakistan, or you know, making Pakistan an interlocutor, actually would create long-term chaos in this region. Now, while clear agreement has been forced on the withdrawal of the foreign forces and on not allowing Afghanistan's soil for the use of foreign terror group, agreement on a comprehensive ceasefire and intra-Afghan dialogue, once considered the minimum red lines or starting point of engagement with Taliban, have now been made the last priority. And this is the concern point for India, that including, I mean, all the parties who are there for democratic process in Afghanistan is actually left out. Nobody is talking about that. And those were the initially considered as the minimum red line or the starting point of engagement with Taliban, that Taliban would not tinker with the system that is installed in last 20 years. Now, these talks have also broken the most important red line, and that of being led by, or at least held with, the full backing and knowledge of the democratically led government in Kabul. And the example is quoted here. Afghan National Security Advisor Hamdullah Mohib lashed out at Mr. Khalid Jad for delegitimizing the Ashraf Ghani government by carrying out talks in the dark. Now, let's talk about India. What about India? Where is India? Where does India stand? Now, talks continue without acknowledging a role for India, despite this being an expressly stated goal of Mr. Trump's South Asia policy. When Mr. Trump had come and when he had intended to pull out of Afghanistan, he had said that India would be the key player in any kind of political decision or the negotiation, or in fact a final conclusion that is arrived at, India would be a party to it. But in reality, India is left out. Now, US State Department's idea towards international support for the Afghan peace process, the role each party can play in bringing an end to the war and progress to date in peace talk, includes only a special envoy from Russia, China and European Union. And this shows that while Pakistan is the default party, so Pakistan is there to bring Taliban on the table. And who all are the special envoy? Those are Russia, China and political leaders from European Union. But India is not there, and that is what is frustrating India. Now, what are the worries for India? Uncertainty of the Afghanistan future that these talks have wrought, that worries India. Objective of the talk was to try to mainstream the insurgents into political process. This was the mainstream, and that's what America or the big parties have always been saying, that we cannot leave out Taliban if we want to bring in sustained long-term peace in Afghanistan. And what exactly is happening? And at least have a working ceasefire by the time of presidential election. But in reality, the Taliban continues to carry out terror attack in Afghanistan, even as its leadership is talking with US. So basically, Taliban is dictating its term and has very well understood that it is on the driver's seat. Now, despite the Ministry of External Affairs issuing a statement on the importance of holding the presidential election, the Afghan vote has been further postponed to September 28th. This makes Mr. Ghani's, that is the president of Afghanistan, continuance more tenuous than under the constitution, which could mean an interim government will be installed, something India has always been opposed to. Now, New Delhi is worried about the prospect of chaos and civil war, akin to the scene after the previous US pullout in early 90s, and India was the biggest loser in that situation. In fact, Air India's plane was hijacked and had gone to Kabul. So there was absolutely no talk with Afghanistan government at that point of time. So India is actually you know, afraid of similar kind of situation. And says that in early 90s, that cut India out and brought the Taliban to power in Kabul with Pakistan's support. So this may happen again. Now this time India was on the wrong foot again. Direct open talk between India and the Taliban at this point actually would serve little purpose for either side. For India, it would mean casting aside a consistently held moral principle and speaking to a non-state actor that espouses terrorism. That's what it would mean. Because, you know, had India initiated that, then India would have been taken as a harbinger of peace. But now, joining the bandwagon in the end would actually mean that India is ditching its friend in Kabul and it would lose its moral principle. Furthermore, it would mean that now India is ready to talk with non-state actors, because India has always maintained that Taliban is a non-state actor. While back-channel talks between intelligence agency and the Taliban have been conducted for years, recognizing the Taliban as a legitimate interlocutor for India at this point would be a betrayal of India's values without any visible gain. So what should India do? So author says there is a window of hope. Because 2019 is not 1989 and much has changed inside Afghanistan. And what are the changes? It is unlikely that Taliban would today be able to overrun and hold Kabul or any other big Afghan city as it did before. It also seems inconceivable that a full withdrawal of US troops will include giving up all the bases they hold at present. So the author is saying that first thing, that situation of 1989 would not be repeated because much has changed. We would be seeing as what all have changed. Furthermore, America's withdrawal would not mean that America would completely withdraw. It still would hold some of its key strategic positions. Further, given technology, social media and the progress in education in Afghanistan since 2001, the number of secondary graduates have risen from 10,000 to more than 3 lakh in 2015. It is also unlikely that the Taliban will be able to control the hearts and minds of the Afghanistan if it were to revert to its brutal ways. So, the author is saying that in case of Taliban returns to its brutal way, it would not be able to hold long. So it will have to mend its ways. Now, since Afghani people love India, many have studied from India and are contesting for presidential election. India could work with these Afghan leaders to support a grand jirga that ensures that the maximum number of representatives from across Afghanistan articulate their post reconciliation vision. Now India is a host to a sizable population of Afghanistan who live, work and study in India, and India could use influence of these people to organize this grand jirga. Overall, Moscow could bring Taliban on table due to Afghan people's Russian connection. So this is important point, and the author is saying India should not lose hope and should try to influence the population who have studied in India or who are studying in India to get into the team of those who are pro democracy in Afghanistan and with the leaders who have got close alliance with India. Now, despite all the many reasons for despondency, it is necessary that Indian strategists do not lose sight of a bigger picture. And what's that? India's long-standing relationship with the people of Afghanistan. This is a relationship nurtured by every government in New Delhi, with more than $3 billion invested by India since 2001, which has reaped many-fold returns in terms of goodwill and friendship across Afghanistan. Defeatism or lack of ambition for the Indian-Afghanistan relationship at this juncture would be much more detrimental to India's interest than anything the Taliban return in Afghanistan to Afghanistan's political centuries can do. So basically, what author is saying that even if Taliban returns to center stage, India should not be losing hope. It should not, despite all many reasons for this despondency, there still is a chance for India, and India should try to, should not lose that goodwill that it has generated among the heart of Taliban people. The kind of work that India has done, India should not withdraw itself. Now we move to the next article, that is the Kerala alert. What is the concern? There needs to be a greater surveillance across India for West Nile virus. And what's the worrisome? This West Nile virus microbe is serologically similar to the Japanese encephalitis virus, which means a go-to test, that is ELISA, often fails to differentiate between Japanese encephalitis antibodies from West Nile virus antibodies. More tests are typically needed to confirm West Nile virus, and while the result appears in journals, they don't always make it to the state surveillance system. This is why, though a 2014 journal in Clinical Virology paper identified the 2001 Alappuzha outbreak as WNS with around 6 deaths, Kerala's health department is calling the Malappuram death as the first in the state. This is because of this confusion that normal ELISA test bring in, because at times either it would call or it would indicate Japanese encephalitis as WNS, or it might call WNS as Japanese encephalitis. Since it is not that deadly, it has not raised alarm, and or the author is saying probably that there was a case of WNS in 2014, but since the WNS or West Nile virus is not that deadly, because of that there was no alarm at that point of time. But then it is very reasonable now to act on it and should raise alarm regarding this death in Malappuram. There is a good chance the virus is a significant cause of acute encephalitis syndrome, the infamous basket of illness with no known etiology or set of cause that affect over 10,000 Indians each year. Still, West Nile fever rarely kills. In less than 1% of the infection, the virus travels to the brain, triggering potentially fatal encephalitis. Otherwise, it merely causes a wild flu-like illness. But we need to understand this, that in 2014, there was no alarm and it was called as Japanese encephalitis. It might be Japanese encephalitis, but the point is that since ELISA test, which has been generally used, might have wrongly put WNS or might have wrongly recognized West Nile virus as virus of Japanese encephalitis, it is important now that we should not take it for granted, because situation now can be more worrisome and can lead to a greater trouble. How is what author has explained? Viruses are known to adapt for both greater virulence and more efficient transmission. Urbanization and land use change are bringing the virus's zoonotic host, such as the bird, in more frequent contact with humans. Given the increased mobility, viruses can hitch a ride to a new region via infected humans and vectors. All this makes West Nile virus a formidable foe. India's best defense is better surveillance, which will help doctors reach patients early to prevent the complication. And this is the important point what author is trying to point out, that we should not, there might have been West Nile virus in 2014 and that time nothing happened, but now we are in 2019 and there is increased mobility, there is a change in the urbanization landscape, there is a change in mobility, there is a change in the way we conduct ourselves. So it is important that we must understand that spread can very well happen. Now this time we have rightly identified this Malappuram virus as West Nile virus, we should swiftly act on it, otherwise it may spread in different region. Now we come to the next article, that is revolutionary ideas that live on. It is quite an important, it reminds me of my first mains examination of 2007, and there was a question on Bhagat Singh. Evaluate the contribution of revolutionary terrorism represented by Bhagat Singh to the cause of India's struggle for independence. I still remember I had written only two lines related to revolutionary terrorism ideas of Bhagat Singh, and then I switched to his other ideas, which was related to poverty, which was related to equality, which was related to awakening of the country. He talked more about these facts. He talked about socialism. He talked about eradicating poverty or untouchability. Then I switched that, although this measure, I mean revolutionary terrorism, was taken by him to awake the mass, and maybe it was a starter, but ultimately he moved to the very idea of socialism. Let's see what author says. He says Bhagat Singh's intellectual bequest should be a beacon of light to build a new India. And what is his analysis? Bhagat Singh went to a gallows along with two of his comrades, Sukhdev and Rajguru, on March 23rd, that is today, in 1931. Bhagat Singh stand out in bold relief as someone who at a young age defined nation and nationalism for us. He had an alternative framework of governance, which is strongly reflected in the corpus of writing that he had left behind. Sadly, we hardly care to revisit this serious intellectual inheritance and only venerate him as a martyr. And this veneration is laudable but incomplete. And that's why I have put this question, which was asked in 2007. Just see, the question is only talking about the contribution of revolutionary terrorism represented by Bhagat Singh. The question was only about revolutionary terrorism. It would have been apt if the question paper or the question had talked more about the very detailed idea that Bhagat Singh had towards Indian society or the model Indian society. Let's see what Bhagat Singh had in his mind and what Bhagat Singh had advocated for. In Matwala, a Hindi magazine from Calcutta, Bhagat Singh wrote an article whose subject was Universal Brotherhood, which was not a very easy issue to write on such a young age. He imagined a world where all of us being one and none is the other. All those who are busy othering and creating strangers out of their own fellow citizen need to grapple with Bhagat Singh's view instead of merely glorifying him as martyr. This is what author says. His strongest critique was of untouchability and communalism, which continues to torment us as a nation even today. He was fiercely frank and bold enough to critically comment on the politics of senior leaders such as Lala Lajpat Rai and express his differences. When Lala Lajpat Rai showed his closeness with Hindu Mahasabha, Bhagat Singh openly criticized him. In 1928, he wrote, "Our country is in a really bad shape. Here, the strangest questions are asked, but the foremost among them concerns the untouchables. For instance, would contact with an untouchable mean defilement of an upper caste?" Bhagat Singh steadfastly remained committed to the idea of plural and inclusive India. He founded Naujawan Bharat Sabha in Lahore in 1926, whose manifesto said religious superstitions and bigotry are the great hindrance in our progress. They have proved an obstacle in our way and we must do away with them. In 1928, Bhagat Singh was acutely conscious of the divisiveness of mixing religion with the politics, and what did he wrote? If religion is separated from politics, then all of us can jointly initiate political activities, even though in matters of religion we might have many differences with each other. This is quite a beautiful point that he had said at that point of time at such a tender age. We feel that the true well-wisher of India would follow these principles and save India from the suicidal path it is on at present. This is what he said in 1928. We must remember, this is what is said by Bhagat Singh in 1928, and he had said that India is on a suicidal path because India is mixing, people are mixing religion with politics, and that's suicidal, and that's what we are witnessing in a grave form. Writing on anarchism, Bhagat Singh observed, our retrogressive thinking is destroying us. We keep ourselves entangled in futile discussion about God and heaven and remain busy in talking about the soul and God. We are quick to dub Europe as capitalist and don't think about their great ideas or pay any attention to them. We love divinity and remain aloof from the world. This is what an anarchist stood for. Bhagat Singh reaffirmed, he was not a bloodthirsty young man who believed in the bomb and the pistol, as the colonial government labeled all revolutionary. And in fact, we also are saying the same, because we still ask the question, revolutionary terrorism as represented by Bhagat Singh. Well, the author says, today we need to remember his revolutionary ideas, not revolutionary terrorism. Mere valorization of his nationalism and ultimate sacrifice is true, but sadly incomplete. In these rancorous times, his intellectual bequest should be a beacon to build a new India. This we should understand, we should keep in mind. This particular article I have chosen because in the idea that Bhagat Singh had given at that point of time, unfortunately, none of us, or I would not say none of us, most of us do not even know, or probably we have not read. It is important that we read and think in that line, at least our question, in case questions are asked on Bhagat Singh, or in fact the political structure or so political consciousness in our country, these points which were given by Bhagat Singh in 1920s can be used even today. And whatever the lines that I have mentioned, or the quotes that of Bhagat Singh that I have mentioned, would actually can be used for your mains examination answer. So this is all for today. Thank you very much.